little bit. So I thank the organizer for the wonderful opportunity of being here. Despite the heat, it's a great place. So if we don't die, it's a wonderful place to look around. And also I will take a minute to advertise this staff exchange program that we have Caligula, because they asked me to do it. So this is a European Union fund that we got to do staff exchange. It's about Cartan geometry, Lie representation theorem, integrable system, quantum groups, quantum computing, and machine learning. And if you want to know more about this, I have the website, but you can ask me, especially if your institution wants to join, we welcome that. And it's a network, there are many institutions, there will be more to come, and we need help to spend the money, okay? So please ask me. Okay, so this is the 1 minute about the Caligula. Now, let me tell you the hypothesis that we're in. The reason being that I will speak about quantum groups, but before I do that, let us fix what we are talking about. So classically, we will look at deformations of a complex semi-simple algebraic group. So these objects are really like very few, so to speak. So like the special linear group, the orthogonal. So there is a list of them, and we are going to take one of them, and of course, also direct product of them. And then we look at some close algebraic subgroup. Again, this is a very strong hypothesis. So we take P parabolic. What that means is that these subgroups, for example, if you don't know what they are, so for example, if you're looking at SL2C, you know, these are the 2x2 matrices, of course, with determinant equal to 1. And then the parabolic, a parabolic here is the following. So it's the one with a zero here. And it is, in the theory, you can show that if you get me a group, parabolics, so to speak, have always a nice form. You can always, they're always conjugated to a nice form, just to understand what we're talking about. And then we take a character of this parabolic, okay? Now, we have to look at line bundles over G mod P. Now, if you look at this example, which somebody told me much time ago, more than 20 years, so I betray my age, that if you know what's going on in SL2, you essentially know what is going on in all the algebraic groups. This is a bold statement, but contains some truth. So if you look at SL2 mod P, this is the parabolic, this is P1, the complex projective space, not difficult at all to see this. Hence, as an algebraic variety, you can look at the line bundles. Why are you interested in line bundles? Not because I am an algebraic geometer. In fact, I'm not an algebraic geometer. I use algebraic geometry only to arrive to quantization in a faster and better way. Because if you look at the ring containing all the functions that transform according to this character in this way, you retrieve the projective embedding, the coordinate ring of G mod P. I mean, this is a very, not so old, I mean, it's like 50, 60 years old, the theory for all these groups, how to recover the ring of the projective embedding. Because for an affine variety, you have a ring associated to it. And this ring is unique. So isomorphic varieties, isomorphic rings. For projective variety, for example, P1, but also more complicated, Grassmannian, flags, and so on, for all these groups, that's not true. First of all, there is no ring associated to a projective variety in the sense that the only functions globally defined are the constant function. First thing. Second thing is, oh, well, I'm happy because I can look at a projective embedding. I can create with a line bundle a projective embedding of this variety. So I have a ring with this game. Yes, you do, but this ring is not unique. If you change the projective embedding, you are changing the ring. It's a price to pay, okay? So the same algebraic projective variety has a different ring according to the embedding. And how do you pick the embedding? You pick this character. This is, you create the line bundle and then the sections and you keep going. So this is a well-known theory. Yeah, it's not quite old. Okay, so let me look more in detail at this example. So we take SL2C, we take the parabolic, then we get the projective space. Which character do we pick? Well, we pick this character. So you see I do, oops, I can't do this. So you are picking A minus one. You say, why don't you pick A to the, you know, one? Why don't you pick A to the A square, A cube? You can, except that, of course, you create different line bundles, right? And it's not difficult to see that for P1 is A to some power. Okay, A to the N is all the characters, and all the line bundles are parameterized by integers, but some of them will have no global sections, okay? So it depends on your convention. I like to put a minus one, and then will be the negative integers. If you put a plus one, be the positive, whatever, you understand. So for positive slash negative, depending on your convention, you have sections, otherwise you don't. Okay, so this is a fact. Because you try to glue, you don't succeed. And then you see in this case, if we pick A to the minus one, again, because I like the convention, I have this convention, then it is the, is giving me the coordinate ring simply generated by A and C, I put a hat, with no relations, and that's really the homogeneous ring of the projective line. Okay, so. Excuse me? This is O1, indeed. Absolutely, yes. I've been told today to be really down to earth, so I am sorry to the people that know this theory, because I'm saying a bunch of obvious things, but perhaps it's good to review, I think. Okay. No, but for an algebraic geometer, all of this is like, why are you wasting my time? But luckily, we're not among this company, right? So.
About bigger thing. This matrix is a matrix of SL2C.
Yes.
C is the inverse of A.
It is. Thank you. This is so right. I should have written A minus one. Thank you. Yes. Yes. So this, this no. But this one, of course, huh? Is a yes, yes. I'm sorry, you are correct. But we will see more of this more general in a moment. Okay, now we see the Grassmannian. Here, thank you for your very nice observation. Here, no, right? Because here, these are 2x2 matrices, right? So this really D is a matrix, but okay. So we look at this example. We're going to see quantization of all of this in a moment. We define a character of P. Notice that before we had A to the minus one, here we take the determinant of A to the minus one, okay? Now there is a theory called the standard monomial theory. This was worked out by, I think it was Lakshmibai and Seshadri back like 40 years ago. Where they write all the characters for all the groups and the parabolics. So this is like a standard monomial theory. They make all this monumental work. For the SL4, okay, is well known. I mean, it's not that this was known before them, but I'm saying you can do this game for all the groups. And you can write the, you see, the invariants, maybe I compute them, right? Right. You can compute the invariants, it'll be the determinants. So the ring of G mod P with that character is corresponding to the Plucker embedding, and it is the ring generated by the 2x2 determinants inside SL4, okay? So The way to look at it, if you like, of course, I mean, it's just, so you have, this is the 16 entries. Depending on whether you like rows or columns, it makes no difference. I like columns, but if you do rows, it's the same. You take the 2x2 determinants of the first two columns. This amounts to right or left action. Now, if you try to reproduce this property, which is not invariants, these are the semi-invariants, because we are used in off algebras to look at the invariants. So we are look at FGH equal FG, right? So this translates in this property is 1 times F, right? The invariance property. But here, no. We are looking at the semi-invariant. So this character plays a role. Why? Because in the off-algebra theory, when we have algebras, we create a ring of functions. No, here we are not creating a ring of functions. These are sections. With the letter O, I denote the sections of a line bundle. Which you say, okay, they're function. Of course, they're function, but they're not function on your variety. These are sections. So they're valued in the fiber of the line bundle. It is a common mistake because the fiber is C. So you may think, you know, it's a function. No, but that is a mistake. Okay. So this is, now, how do you produce in general a projective embedding? I said it already, so that was a spoiler. You need a character, and then you do the general theory, okay? So if you give me a character, there is this precious element T in the ring of your group G that has that property. That I call it a section, okay? Determining uniquely the line bundle. T is not unique because, you know, you can play with it. But it will determine uniquely the line bundle. This fact people may have known this, but to my knowledge, it was me, Gavarini, and Ciccoli that described this point of view, because we needed it to do the quantization. That is the point. So once you have this element, this precious T, you can create the line bundle. And this T is not, okay, so I want to say something about this T. So you may think, well, of course, Fiorezzi, this is very obvious. You told us that you need this character. T is the character. No, T is not the character. This is the lift. So the character, see, I can't do. So the character is an element, see, from P to C. T is an element in the algebra of the group. So there is a difference. I want to stress this. So T is a function on the group. The character is a function on the subgroup. So there is this difference. Okay, so this is, so let's see the example. So you pick as your T the determinant, the principal minor, this one. So T is the determinant of this one, of this object. And then you use it to generate all the sections. So all the sections will have this property. You may think, okay, that's not a big deal because you already showed us the property. This is true. I showed you the property in the commutative sense. But look, here it's very nice because we can produce it in a non-commutative world. You see my point, right? This is a condition that doesn't need evaluation in any point. Okay, so this is the... So we create, if you check the determinants, dij of these two columns, satisfy this property, and then we create, this T is the object that we really want to quantize. Okay. Everyone happy so far? We go to finally to the quantum world, because that's where we want to go. So this was a very quick review of algebraic geometry. Now, what do we call quantum homogeneous variety. Okay, first of all, for me, when I write CQ, I take Q as an indeterminate. This is not a big deal. If you like a Q to be a number, that's okay. It will work. So it doesn't really have to be an indeterminate, can be specialized. I don't want to get into this because these are algebraic important, but not to communicate ideas, important for proving results. Now, for me, a quantum group is, of course, an off algebra over this ring. I take it torsion free as CQ module, the usual property. But then I want to define what is a quantization of a generic algebra. What is my point? In general, you see, if I tell what a quantization is without further requirement, it's very simple to produce a quantization because you just do whatever you like. But here, I want to do a quantization of an object, so of a quantum homogeneous space. So what I'm asking is that there is a natural coaction. Not only this, but then, you see, I have OQX, which is a quantization. I have a coaction of the quantum group, and I want that everything behaves nicely when Q is specialized to one, okay? I know there are many different definitions. I take this one, I am aware. If you have your own, we can discuss later, okay? I must say that all the theory that we do will accommodate, but this is our hypothesis. So it is not everybody's happy? Okay. Okay, now I have to tell you what is a quantum line bundle. I mean, there is a definition of what is a line bundle in a classical algebraic geometry, but we can't do it here. We need to be smarter. But we are lucky because we understood that this section, precious section, it's this T, see, it was from G to C, will hold all the information about the line bundle, and so we want to quantize it, okay? So we're looking for D in the off algebra with the property that when you apply the delta, the co-multiplication, you get D times D up to an element of your, so it is not group-like, it's almost group-like, it's group-like in the quotient, okay, as your character. Then, of course, you want it that reduces to T, modulo Q minus one, okay. And then once you have this, oops, sorry, I don't know what's going on. It doesn't like, okay, don't touch it. Once you have this quantum section, you produce your ring, okay? So you create your homogeneous ring. So the homogeneous component are all the functions that transform to the power n of this magic section. Yes? It is the, okay, that is very good. So you take the hypothesis is that I have a quantum parabolic subgroup. So I am assuming that you have an off ideal. Okay? No, but thank you, Alessandro, because this is a very strong hypothesis. Okay? If you give me a subgroup, very rarely, right, you have that, very rare. For example, now we're interested in the nilpotent, goodbye, the nilpotent will not have this property. We know this very well, right? Every day we go, so yes, this is a strong hypothesis, but on the other hand, that's what we're doing, okay? So this is our game. So we produce this homogeneous ring OQ G mod P, and it will be a direct sum. Now here I wrote sum, but the truth is that this is a direct sum of all these homogeneous components. And this homogeneous component will multiply nicely. There is no reason a priori why this should happen, but it does. So we have this work that was done in 2008 by me, Ciccoli and Gavarini. So Gavarini is not here, he betrayed us. I went to London, I told Fabio, I'm gonna talk about, okay, whatever. He likes Majid more. Hey, what can we do? Eh? We will remind him about this. Okay. So we take a quantum section on G mod P. Then, very nice. You have that. So you can multiply. So it is true what I said in words. So if you take component R and component S, when you multiply, you are in R plus S. So it is really graded, like this ring. You see, when you look at the homogeneous ring of P1, it has two generators, but respecting the grading. Okay. Then, not only this, but it is also a CQG comodule. So there is a coaction of the off algebra CQG that respects the grading. So it is really very nice. Moreover, it does what it should do. So it is compatible with the specialization to Q equal 1. Okay, so this is very nice. You will produce quantization of homogeneous projective spaces. Perfect, that was done. Now, I do quickly the example, yes, because I want to say more things. Now, let me quickly write an example that quantizes the Grassmannian and, of course, projective space also. So, we look at the quantum matrices ideal given by the ideal of the Manning relations. Now, either you know them and then you say, oh, yeah, of course they're that, but this slide won't help the people that don't know them, of course, because how can you possibly? Okay, well-known. So, and we can define the quantum. So these are the Reshetic intact agent, the deformation with the R matrix. I mean, they're well-known deformations. We look at just at the example of the special linear group. So we take matrices and we specialize the We specialize the determinant equal to one. And then we look at the quantum Grassmannian. What is the key observation? The key observation is that we have a quantum section by taking the quantum determinants, okay? No surprise, they work. You have to check many, many things, but they all work. And indeed, if you look at this ring, the quantum Grassmannian, that by the way, this was done by many people. I think the first one was Seibelmann, I'm not sure, but it was like a long time ago. You see that you retrieve the same algebra. Of course, Seibelmann didn't speak about line bundles, quantum, but I'm saying we recover the same algebra by Seibelmann. Okay. And you generalize easily to n dimension. The only difficulty is to compute the relations, which are not obvious at all. This was done by Taft and Tauber back, I think, in 2000-something, and also by me and my collaborators, because we retrieve them from a different point of view. And you may wonder, how do you do it for quantum flags? You can. You take the quantum section by the principal minors. So you have that for the Grassmannian G24, this is your object. If you're looking at SLN, so this is SLN, you take all the determinants of all the principal minors. This is again the standard monomial theory. And it works, this is a quantum section. They generate the ring of the flag. And you have to compute the relations. These are not fun, but you can do it. So you can recover all these calculations, which I forget who did that first. I don't know. Perhaps it was me. I don't know. Not Taft-Tauber. No. I think like Schmiebeyer and Reshetnikin. Guder, that's true, that was my main competitor, that's right. No, I remember that, yes, that's right, see? No, we are in friendly, absolutely, yes, I, I visited them. Okay, now we go to the principal bundle story, because what we want to do is to understand principal bundles over these objects, okay? So, what is a principal bundle? I apologize because I call E the total space. I know many people call it P, the total space, but how can I call it P? Because P is my group, so I have to make a choice. Okay, so what is a principal bundle? You need a surjective map. I don't want to say, oh, you know, it's differential, yes, it is algebraic, yes, I mean, depending on the category you are interested in. Your group acts freely on from the right on the total space E, and then it acts untransitively on the fiber. Okay, so this is... Flaum gives a shift theoretic definition, so we take it from him, of this classical picture. So we have this classical picture, Flaum says, okay, let's do this. What is for me a P principal bundle? I want a sheaf of H comodule algebras, so your group, the information about the group P is now encoded in the algebra of the function, and the information about the total space is the sheaf on the base. Okay, so this is...
The base is classical.
This is all classical, eh? All classical. Yes, yes, but then it's a very good question. I will come back to this later, whether or not you want classical or no. So you want an open covering on the base, so that the coinvariant are exactly the functions on the base, okay? So you are taking a sheaf on the base, but then the functions will be those on the total space. So this is the idea of Flaum, and I think I like that, because it brings you very far. Now, the truth is that it's a very algebraic definition, so you don't get the infinity functions with this. It's not very suited for the differential category, but okay. And then the local triviality is encoded by saying that you have the isomorphism. Okay, so this is the idea. Okay. And of course, these are the co-invariants, the usual co-invariants. So we take this definition by Flaum. Flaum was interested in a non-commutative setting, and we applied it to our problem. So for us, M is indeed G mod P. And then we want to understand the principal bundle as sheaves. The reason for this is that there is no other way to do it, because you see, you don't have an algebra here. You have only line bundles. So the only way to understand the geometry of principal bundles of non-affine basis, the only way is to do this. I'm just saying that it's not because I like sheaves. Honestly, I don't really totally like them. It's because you have to go through them, that's all. Okay, so what is a quantum principal bundle? So first of all, you take a quantum ring the space, which is a topological space with a sheaf of non-commutative algebras. So coming to your question, a very relevant question, is that, is it really quantum? Is in between, right? Because you have a topological space, honest, but then you have a sheaf of non-commutative objects. So this is the in between, somehow. But it's Flaum, it's not us. Flaum does this, so I'm happy that somebody else, I don't have to defend my idea. What is it, Gianni?
He stopped doing that, he wrote one pair.
Ah, so you think so you think that it was really a bad idea, because...
I was just commenting that Flaum just wrote this pair and then moved it somewhere else.
But I think it was well published. What is it?
Communicate. It's a very nice paper.
Yes, I like that paper.
Chiara and Lucio did some follow-up of this.
So it is not to be thrown away, yeah, Gianni? You're like... Okay, so we take M a topological space, OM is a sheaf of non-commutative algebras, and then we define what is a sheaf, what is an H quantum principal bundle. Okay, so let me give you this definition, then I want to comment. You want a sheaf of H commodule algebras, and I write in parentheses PCA principal commodule algebras because you may want extra hypotheses on it. Depends on what you want to do. Okay, you may ask of Galois right there. I'm just saying the possibilities are many. I just wanted to be really general here. Depends on what you want to do, of course. Then you want an open covering of your algebraic variety M, so that locally the coinvariants are the functions on your variety. Notice that, again, it makes no sense to speak about the global invariants here. They'll be the constant. You have to look at open sets, then will not be the constants. That's the whole point of having a sheaf. I am assuming that people are familiar with sheaves. It did not occur to me to write the definition because, I mean, come on, sheaves, what are they? You can glue. Morally, this is, you assign functions. And then you want the locally cleft property. So you want, So you want that locally you have this isomorphism as commodule. Okay, this is again, you may want trivial or non-trivial, again, depends on what you want to do. And let us see an example of a classical principal bundle. Let us look at my favorite example, SL2, the total space, going on M, which is P1. So in the coordinate algebra, I'm sorry, it is a bit cut, we have two open sets in SL2, V1 and V2, where we are taking A different from zero and C different from zero, okay? This forms an open cover, of course, because you can't have them both as zero. This, I think, everybody agrees. And then we look at the projection of these two open sets. Again, typically, if you take projection of an open, no guarantee it is open, but here, yes, because there are special open sets. And so we can define the sheaf F like that. So we define the sheaf of I invert A1 here, I invert C here, and then on the intersection, I take the two inverse. And of course, if I take the global sections, I get just C. Now, this is a quantum principal bundle over the whole object, okay, P1. This is a classical simple example. You can check all the properties, right? Check the, there is a coaction and so on. Now, let us look at an example of a quantum ringed space, because that's what we have to do, right? If you want to do it in the non-commutative world, you have to pick a quantum space and you have to start building all your construction from it. So let's take the quantum special inner group, this. Okay, and then we build on M, we build this ring, okay? So this is, I cannot show it to you, it will take some time, but this A1, A-1C, it is the invariance with respect to the action of the parabolic, okay? Not so difficult to see because the parabolic will multiply both A and C by something and they will be canceling. So it is really quite fast to see. Okay. What is it, Gianni? No. No, we always take the right, eh? Parabolics act on the right. It's a choice. That's... But in fact, Gianni, you are very good. It is there. You have both. T depend on which open you're looking, right? It is the same. Yes, yes. No, but you are too fast. You want to see. Okay. It is indeed. Okay. Now, how do we see on this quantum ring the principal bundle? It's exactly what we did before. It is the same. So it is very simple. Instead of taking SL2, you take a quantum SL2 and you play this game. And it works perfectly. And of course, this theory is not for SL2, because if we had it for SL2, that'll be too trivial. We have it, of course, in general. Sorry. We have it in general. But this is really to have you understand that our definition works for this very baby example. And then we go for the general. And you also have a more big example. Now, the general theory is a theorem by me, Paolo, and Emanuele Lattini. So we start from this quantum section. Again, quantum section equal line bundle, quantum line bundle. We take a family of elements. You see, when you apply the co-multiplication to D, you get this, you know, the Hopf algebra. These D2 are the second the right leg. So you have a family of D2. And what you're doing, you are taking, the notation is really terrible. You are inverting these objects. Okay. So essentially, what are you doing? No, I'm sorry. I have to write an example because it's very difficult. How do I erase? This one is the eraser. This? Paolo? Ah. No, but that's not the way I wanted to do it. Okay. Fine. Right. So, I just want to write this because, if you take the delta of this, it's very simple. I'm just... So this is... Paolo, no. I feel I am harassed. Okay. So this is your quantum section, okay? Now, where is this guy going? This guy is going to A times A plus B times C. So these are the guys to look, okay? So this is written as what we wrote, D1 times D2. So these are the two elements that create, so this is the ones to invert. So CSL2, A minus 1, CSL2, C minus 1, okay? So you look at this D2, that is... They're not unique. Very good. They're not unique. No. Yes. Okay. So when you invert them, you find the cover that you like. So they always form a cover. So if you invert them, you get a cover. This is a consequence of the Borel veil. Classically, there is a. Okay. Then. This defines a sheaf of OQP comodule algebras, this assignment on these inverses. And the co-invariant, so this object here is the one that I invert. So this is, so this is F of UI. This is the guy upstairs. And then when you take the co-invariants, you get OMUI. Mm. Now, unfortunately, in this very generality, you don't know whether or not you have local triviality. If you have local triviality, yes, then you have a quantum principal bundle. If you don't have local triviality, I mean, we couldn't prove this. We wish it was true more in general, but we didn't see. Now, we have an example for the special inner group in general. So again, I want to say some words about the example, perhaps really fast. Right, so you can play the same game where you take a parabolic instead of this little guy, where you put C equals zero, you take a larger parabolic inside SL2. Of course, the quotient is the projective space of dimension n minus one. And you know that I forgot the Q here. This is well known. I think Gianni, a lot of people have written the quantum projective space, yourself also. This has been well studied. And we can reinterpret this construction as principal bundle. So we take this parabolic that I gave, and then you take as a quantum section the element A11, and then you produce the quantum principal bundle. So I'm just... So what we proved is that if you assign, you take OQ, the ring of the special linear quantum group, and then you invert all of these AIJ, so what are they? Sorry, it's becoming a bit technical, I'm sorry. So this is, So you are looking at these elements because these are exactly the second leg of the co-multiplication. So if you invert them, it's them that you have to invert, you find that this assignment defines a quantum principal bundle and that the invariants are really the projective quantum space. So this was the example in our paper. So I want to take, so are we happy so far? Because I want to take the last part of the talk to say something about the quantum differential calculus in this framework. Sort of happiness, but I know it's very difficult because after lunch, organizer is very difficult. I have the advantage that I'm standing. All right. So we take an off algebra, we take H comodule algebra, and then what do we mean by H covariant first order differential calculus? We just take a bimodule omega. I guess that most of us know this definition, so that we have a map, C linear map, which is the D, satisfying the Leibniz rule, satisfying this somehow surjective property. And then we want covariance. So we want this delta H defined in such a way to be well defined. What is the point here? You say, oh, wait a moment, you define it, so what is the point? The point is that, of course, omega is generated by these elements, right? But it's not, you have to check that this guy is well defined. Generators are not enough. So, this is a definition of quantum differential calculus by many people. Now, certainly everything I'm saying is in the book of Majid and is probably able to do a better attribution than I. Okay. Now, how to define quantum differential calculus on quantum principal bundles? It's not so difficult because, well, the definition is simple. It's finding properties that is not so trivial. Is exactly what you think. So you have your sheaf of H comodule algebras, which is a quantum principal bundle. You have your cover that allows you to retrieve the functions on the base as covariants. You have the local triviality, so this is conditional local triviality. And then we define first order differential calculus on this sheaf as another sheaf, of course, must be, with the following. Now, D is not anymore a function as we know it, because you want D to be defined for all the open, okay? This is a bit technical. I don't want to get into how you do this because, you know, I'm giving a definition so I can do whatever I want. But of course, if I wanted to give examples, I need to do to give a definition that is workable. As it looks like, it's not workable, but it's not difficult. So you give D as a natural transformation that locally on an open cover satisfies Leibniz rule. We can talk about stocks, whatever. If you're interested, we can discuss what this word locally means, because it's a kind of a very generic word. And then you want that this surjectivity holds on an open cover. And finally, again, the H covariance hold for an open cover. Okay, so this is very, very general. Now, what we did after giving this definition that is perfectly in line with other word on quantum principal bundle, we try to prove results and give examples. That is, so you can define, well, you have a quantum groups, you have a pairing. This is the usual, what can I say, the usual gymnastic with this. So you have co-invariant forms, very natural. You can have, you know, this is something that one is looking at. But not only this, you also have the horizontal forms, which are killed by a vector field in P. Okay, so this is, I am aware that the notion of vector field is not so straightforward, but let's pretend it is, and let us write this. Okay, so we have co-invariance for an horizontal form. So what do you expect? You expect exactly as in the classical theory that the differential forms on the base comes at the intersections of these two objects, defined in this very general way. And in fact, we have this work with Paolo Emanuele Latini and Thomas Weber in 2021. Actually, I should say 2022, and maybe 23, because we change it many times. So it's a mistake that year. Okay. So if we have a bicovariant calculus on OQG, this induces as a covariant differential calculus as quantum principal bundle on the base. And before you think this is known, this is not known if this object, you see, this is not the algebra of coinvariance. This is the strange graded algebra coming out of the line bundle. So it is something more complicated. Then this OQG not only induces, but you have that the differentials on the base comes by looking at the co-invariance. Sorry, I don't know why I wrote this. This is the correct one. Ah, no, no, okay. If you define, the differential forms on the base exactly as you think, you obtain this result, this very classical fact that the differential form on the base is obtained by taking the co-invariance and you intersect with the horizontal, those that are killed by the vector fields. So this is something, okay. So the bibliography is right here. So is the work with Paolo regarding quantum principal bundle, the work with Thomas, Paolo and Latini regarding principal bundles, and finally these two are our references regarding the prerequisites they were, they're necessary to understand this. So I'm finished and I'll be taking questions. Thank you very much. Yes.
So you mentioned the Borel Bay theorem for a second. If there must be a Borel Bay theorem somewhere in the background of all this quantum settings, what your view?
Yes. So, yes, let me show you where it is. This was in our paper with Fabio, because the Borel veil is not regarding quantum principal bundle. This is already in quantum homogeneous spaces, I think. So when you are, so in our paper with Fabio, by the way, this is also in Eckenberger-Kolb, this thing. Yes, it is there. Not that they don't express it, but it is contained there. So I show you where it is. But I'm not sure we spelled out. I have to speak with Fabio. But where is it? Okay, I don't find it anymore. Okay, it's some. No, it was before principal bundles is right before. Okay, I give up. If I find it in a moment, yes. Ah, it's right here. So when you look at this object, right? So at each component, there'll be your representation. Because you see, you have the op is here, right? You were going too fast. What were you saying?
What you're looking at is the homogeneous coordinate.
Yes. 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 No, it's right here. It's hidden here. Because you have a representation of your quantum group here, right? That's it. But I think, first of all, I don't remember if we made a note of it in our paper. But I'm pretty sure that Kolb does this. He's talking about something called matrix element. He's doing something like that. Yes, okay. So we don't claim a priority because it was there. Okay. Yes, but it's here. Yeah. Yes. It is the same. Yes, because this lives inside the CQG, so it is there. Yeah. Okay, Jan. Yes, Jan. The global triviality. The global triviality. Yes. First of all, in our theory, we are not worried about that, right? No, this is a good question, so this... No, I understand. So certainly when you look at SLN as a bundle over the Grassmannian, that is non-trivial for sure.
Yes, but how do you show it here in the quantum?
In the quantum world, okay. So if in the quantum world it were trivial, it would go the triviality when Q equal 1 in the specialization. So that's a way to say this. But trivial in the algebraic category is so rare that people don't really bother about that, right? I mean, they're never trivial, ever. But it's the symphony category is more flexible, right? Of course, yes. Yes.
There may be a way to check. There are examples where it's difficult to check.
Yes, so we give a quantization of projective varieties for which classically we know there is no such thing. So we get that, but if we were doing other clever examples, you are right, we should have a way to check, but we don't have a result saying, so we don't compute cohomology, nothing, we don't do that. Yeah.
That's an interesting suggestion.
No,
some cohomology on this.
No, in fact, there are many things we could do that we don't. That is, no, I'm...
We will do it.
Uh, Yes, given infinite time, but you are a physicist, you know that all states will be reached if you have infinite time, right? This is what the ergodic hypothesis, what is it? No, no, but thank you.
Please.
No, no, don't ask me about cohomology, I don't know how to compute. In fact, okay, this is I failed to convey that indeed our line bundle is an associated bundle because you have a representation of P, a character is a representation of P, is a very small representation, one dimensional, right? And then we build a quantum, okay? But this is very nice, I like that, to construct quantum associated bundles. That's incredible, yes, it is there. We don't do it, but it is there. We could be doing it, yes. There is a theory that this theory is, I don't want to say the word trivial, but it is explored in the case that the base is affine, because you can play with that. But when the base is projective, then it is to build this, because, yes, yes, this is... This is a question for Paolo that is doing this, right? You're doing some gauge, non-commutative gauge.
Yes,
no, I don't do it, but I know Paolo as an industry, right? Paolo, you are working.
Let's say that this is a program to replace of Galois extension in the case the base is projective. And so it's, it turns out, as Rita is advocating, it's more common. So all these questions that you are posing are indeed very interesting. But
yeah.
Require some extra work, and some of them have to be settled first in the affine case, I would say.
No, we haven't done it, but it is definitely a way to go. Yes, yes. Gianni.
Trivial. This is trivial.
Go.
Not in the sense.
Now I'm worried.
Just out of curiosity, in these projective spaces,
yes.
There are line bundles and
yes.
Spot on with the objects. Are you constructing, for instance, on CP2?
Yes.
A1 bundle with an SU2 bundle. So A1 bundle comes out of a sphere and then it's via your character. But in this case, the character just selects an associate.
It's very good, as Patrizia is saying, it's a very nice suggestion. We have not done it, but this is a road to go, I think, yes.
So the idea is that you have to construct an humble line bundle and then using
this. We just do line bundle. But I must say that you both are correct. This construction does not... It's not forbidden to replicate for more complicated representation. There is no reason why you shouldn't do, instead of taking one-dimensional representation, you could be taking higher dimension and build.
It would be extremely interesting to go beyond the line bundle.
Yes.
One of the problems with the advantage of a line bundle is that if you multiply them together, it's still a line bundle.
Yes.
When you construct, let's say, for instance, the instant of bundle,
yes, yes.
Two cross-set time scales is not any longer.
Yes, yes. No, I understand. I think I'm trying to work as much as I can. I have my limits, but very good. Yes, yes. Thank you.
So, if there are some more general questions, please.
Yes, yes, of course.
So, yeah.
Yes, yes, Alessandro, this is a very good question. I didn't want to get into these technicalities because I wanted to keep this talk general, but of course we do, yes, yes.
So when you do the forward motion?
Yes, absolutely. No, It was skimming a lot, this, there are a lot of technical difficulties, I just was, you know, glad. But you are right, yes, we do that. Yes, as Patrizia was saying, why not? Yes. Why not? Yes, he was talking about the instanton bundle, right, where fiber is. Absolutely, yes. Why not? I think there are all directions to explore. I'll be very happy to talk to you about that. Yes, yes, of course.
Yeah. So
yes.
You talked about bundles. Now, but you also about the homogeneous spaces themselves. So I suppose you have to want to say that it's not homogeneous spaces also. Then what is the underlying Poisson structure? Is it the general?
Poisson?
Poisson structure, which is underlying.
Okay. So this is actually a question that has nothing to do with my construction, right? Because we never stop and think.
Yeah.
But this construction, I mean, I think there are works actually by my collaborator Ciccoli regarding what is the Poisson structure coming out of this quantization.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, these are orbits, right? So, the, you know, the Kirillov, this is for sure.
Yeah, but that's exactly my question. I would have thought that
then apparently you know way more than I do on this topic.
It's really a Poisson.
So it's a quantization of the general.
The orbit space is degenerating the image.
Yeah. Ah, you know more, I'm sorry about that. I'm no expert at all in Poisson. But you are correct in your question because one of my collaborators, Ciccoli, Nicola, he was motivated in, by this, by looking at Poisson structure. So he was, we were looking at the coisotropic subgroups in order to study those, but I'm sorry, I didn't go into there because that's not my expertise. I'm sorry, but you are right. They are connected. Yes.
So I would suggest to stop the general discussion here. Thank you, speaker.
Thank you.